watching ESPN, new home of the Bowl Championship Series.
Well, down to the field just a few moments ago, the anticipation palpable and tangible for both Auburn and Kentucky, but especially the Tigers of Auburn, who have a chance to get a leg up in the SEC West, the result of Alabama's loss against South Carolina a few moments ago. There's a look at their head coach, Gene Chizik, who says, hey, in the next 3 weeks, we're going to find out just how far we've come from a season ago. This is where they hit their rough stretch last year. Meanwhile, on the other side of the field, Joker Phillips is the first-year head coach for the Kentucky Wildcats. Their team two games down in the SEC East, and they have a very important three-game homestand coming up. This, the first of the three games, paramount that they play well today against Auburn. Kentucky will receive the opening kick.
You have to wonder if these Auburn fans, there's a lot of fans here in orange jerseys, if they're not exhausted, cheering so hard for South Carolina in that game earlier this afternoon. I mean, the roar in this stadium when South Carolina scored, you'd have thought there was a live game going on.
You could feel their anticipation. Auburn Tigers have been involved in several close games already this year. And here's what it looks like in the SEC's Eastern Division. Kentucky sitting at 0-2, so it's vital that they come out and get one today. But it's not going to be easy against the Auburn Tigers, who come in perfect in conference play, 2-0 and 5-0 overall. But of those five wins, three of them have come by 7 points or less. Kick from West Byram. This is Cobb from the 15. Finds a seam. Randall Cobb. An electrifying beginning for Kentucky. A 37-yard return and a great start, Bob, for the Wildcats.
Well, you don't have much choice if you're Auburn, because you're either going to kick it to Derek Locke or Randall Cobb. This time they kick it to Cobb, and he takes it right up that sidelines.
Mike Hartline, the starting quarterback for the Wildcats, 6'6", a senior, doing a great job of seeing things and staying within the discipline of the system that they're running so far this year. First and 10. Completes his first pass to Cobb. And Cobb is lethal in space. Close to the first down at the 40-yard line, a 9-yard gain. Bob, let's take a look at the impact players.
I think everyone knows for Kentucky on offense, it's all about number 20 and number 18. Tailback Derek Locke, number one in the SEC in total offense per game. Randall Cobb, number three in the SEC in total offense per game. These guys are fun to watch. On defense, you want to stop them? Penetration causes havoc. Nick Fairley leads the SEC in tackles for loss.
Here's a look at Cobb in the Wildcat. They haven't shown it much this year, but he picks up enough for the first down. So keep your eyes posted. Keep them peeled back on number 18. He's a vital part of what Coach Joker Phillips' team does. Take a look at the rest of the offense for the Kentucky Wildcats after that first down run. Monstel Allen, a.k.a. Turtle Man, one of the best blocking fullbacks in the SEC. And Chris Matthews, a nice compliment to Cobb on the other side receiving. Three new starters on that offensive line as well. First and 10 from the 36. Complete to Locke. And Locke gets another first down at the 25-yard line, an 11-yard gain. Let's take a look at the defense now for the Auburn Tigers. We talked about Nick Fairley, but Antoine Carter, a nice compliment with three sacks on the outside, number 45. The linebackers led by Josh Bynes. He runs the operation. And as for the secondary, Thorpe and Washington on the corners, Savage and Zach Etheridge, the safeties. Locked on the carry, puts his hat down and makes a little bit of noise with another first down at the 13-yard line. He ran through and over Nico Thorpe.
We met with Derek Locke yesterday. A couple things you notice about him. He's not very tall, but he is really packed, really strong, and he is really confident. Almost an arrogance to him.
Here he is between the tackles, showing you he can run between the tackles and Bob. You mean arrogant in a very flattering way, right?
I really do. You know, he's a lot like Randall Cobb in that neither one of these guys were very highly recruited out of high school. Always heard about what they weren't. Weren't tall enough, weren't big enough, weren't fast enough. They both play with a big-time chip on their shoulder.
Hey, if you weren't recruited by Kentucky and you're the starting tailback, you might have a bit of a chip on your shoulder as well. Here's Cobb out of the Wildcat and brought down at about the 2-yard line. A 3-yard gain and a first down for the Wildcats. In rhythm and in sync here on the opening drive.
Well, you mentioned it earlier. Randall Cobb, not as much Wildcat this year. Only came in with 13 rushes. But in those 13 rushes, averaged 9.4 a carry. Because so you can see just how big this game is for Kentucky. Because look who's at quarterback again here.
Randall Cobb again in the Wildcat. Keeps it himself. Touchdown, Kentucky. Extra point good, and the 19th rushing touchdown of Randall Cobb's career.
Out of the Wildcat, the fake misdirection, the big tackle pulling around. Cobb gets into the end zone. That ball came out once he crossed the plane of the goal line.
He had gotten in first. Seven plays, 49 yards, set up by that nice kickoff return by that guy, Randall Cobb. 3:09 on the clock, eclipse. And Bob, you said at the top of the show we were going to get a lot of points in this game.
Yeah.
You're going to buy into that.
I think this is really going to be a high-scoring football game because look who's coming on the field next, number two, Cam Newton.
You couldn't draw up or script a better beginning for the Kentucky Wildcats, who had problems last week in their loss against Mississippi, the result of turnovers. Well, good ball security on that drive.
And Auburn talked all week about identifying where number 20 and number 18 are going to be. The problem isn't figuring out where they're going to be. The problem is tackling those two guys because they are dynamic football players with their hands on the ball now.
Getting a look at DeMond Washington, number 14, and Ontario Caleb. Going to return this kick for Auburn. This is Washington. And Washington is brought down at the 23-yard line. When you look at Cameron Newton, you notice his imposing size and his presence. 6'6", 250 pounds, a junior. He's second in the nation in pass efficiency. Auburn is a team number one in passing efficiency.
And he's rested. didn't carry the football one time last week against Louisiana Monroe. Still averaging 94 yards a game rushing without a carry last week.
There are whispers about him in a burgeoning Heisman campaign, but Kentucky has a different script today. This is McCaleb on the game's first carry for the Tigers, and he makes it out to the 25-yard line, picking up three. Let's take a look at the impact players.
Well, freshman Michael Dyer's developed into the go-to ball carrier for Auburn. Let's see if he can take some pressure off of Cam Newton. Terrell Zachary, their second leading receiver, but Gus Malzahn said they're going to try to get him the ball more tonight. The Quinn Evans, defensive end for Kentucky.
Tackle made by Ukwu on Cameron Newton, and Newton picked up two on the play. It's going to be third down and about five to go. This is a high-paced, fast-paced Auburn offense. They like to get the ball to the official right after the play's dead, huddle over it, and get going again. Third and five coming up. Mariel Fannin in the backfield now beside Cam Newton. Flags down. This is where Newton makes things happen on his own, and the improvisation nets them a first down at about the 32-yard line. He picked up six, but let's see if it stands. There's a flag back at the 27.
There are two fouls on the play. Offside, defense. Illegal formation, number 75. Offense was not on the line of scrimmage. Penalties offset, replay third down.
Well, let's play it over again. Did you see Cameron Newton, most dangerous, scrambling?
Third and five. This is usually Darvin Adams' time, number 89. Newton under some heat. Unloads incomplete. And a late flag thrown on the play. It was intended for Darvin Adams. Randall Burden was in the neighborhood.
Well, that really came out late. Again, you see the scrambling ability of Cam Newton keeping that play alive.
Pass interference, number 24, defense.
Well, it's bump and grind the whole time.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I saw was they kind of get their legs caught up together early. I didn't see much at the time of impact right there with the football.
First down and 10 at about the 42-yard line. McCaleb beside Newton in the backfield. Newton with the pump fake and drills one incomplete to Adams at midfield. And let's check in with Reese in the studio.
Mark, thank you very much. As a Taco Bell studio update, it's a potential trap game no more. Alshon Jeffrey, the 45-yard reception from Steven Garcia, and South Carolina has knocked off the number one team in the country. Mark?
And Cam Newton scrambles for 5 yards down to the 45. A play is never really dead when Newton has the football.
Well, if you're sitting at home, you figured out that number two for Auburn is going to touch the football a lot, and number 18 and number 20 for Kentucky are going to touch the football a lot. Three of the most dangerous players in all of college football, and creative offensive coaches to take advantage of it.
There's Michael Dyer. And Dyer picks up a couple of yards. Dyer, the highly touted freshman, ranked by some services, including ESPN, as the number one tailback coming out of high school last year.
We look at Gus Malzahn They broke three offensive records last year in his first year as offensive coordinator. He recruited Michael Dyer, started in the ninth grade when Gus was at Arkansas recruiting Michael Dyer out of Little Rock.
Blake in motion. Newton completes it to Fannin, who makes a great catch. His forward progress is going to be marked at about the 41-yard line, so that'll give him a 3-yard gain. Nice to see Mario Fannin back and playing well for the Tigers, coming off that shoulder injury. But what about the prolific offense under Gus Malzahn?
That's incredible. You look at those offensive increases. Was a high school coach in the state of Arkansas, went to Tulsa. Actually went to Arkansas, then Tulsa, and found a home here at Auburn.
Third and five. Newton making lemonade out of lemons once again. Cam Newton with a great straight arm on middle linebacker Ronnie Snead to pick up 16.
You talk about size, you talk about speed, but right here you're going to talk about strength as well. I mean, that's a man. That is 6'6", all of 250 pounds. He just kind of toys with you out in the open field. I mean, he doesn't have to put the afterburner on. He thinks about running over you, too.
He told Ronnie Snead, you better talk to the hand. Little option, Fannin. Fannin breaks the tackle inside the 15, and the Tigers on the move. Close to another first down, picked up about 9, almost 10.
Cody Burns, watch number 18 at the top, right there. That's a former quarterback out there blocking in the open field on Martavius Nellums for Kentucky.
McCaleb in the backfield now. Newton keeps it. Cam Newton walks through the park for a touchdown. Well, Tigers against Wildcats is like a Seabiscuit against Secretariat here in horse racing country, Bob.
Yeah, when that gate opens, they're out of that gate fast now.
The extra point good, and we are tied at 7 apiece with 6:44 to go in the first quarter of play. Lots of points to come. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Welcome back, everyone, to the SEC on ESPN as we take a look at our drive recap brought to you by Chick-fil-A. Kentucky's opening kickoff really set up that scoring drive by Randall Cobb. Cobb and Locke, Bob, getting a lot done on this drive.
You're right, and it all started with the great special teams play. You look at the power right there of Derek Locke, and then you look at the wild Cobb formation with Randall Cobb at quarterback. The only thing Auburn needs to do to match, put Cam Newton back there returning kicks like they use Locke and Cobb.
Not a bad idea. We promised you pyrotechnics, fireworks, offensively in this game. And about halfway through the first quarter, it's lived up to it. Cody Parkey kicking off now for Auburn. Last time they had Byram do it, this is going to be Derek Locke from the goal line. Locke brought down at about the 23.
Here's how difficult it is. Watch McCaleb, the running back. He comes across as a potential ball carrier. Watch the linebacker widen as he sees McCaleb, and then Cam Newton's going to keep the football. So keep your eyes on the linebacker. There comes McCaleb. The linebacker runs himself out of there. And then Cam Newton just glides into the end zone. But a lot of misdirection. But I know this. If I'm a linebacker, key number two. Because number two is going to end up keeping that football.
Auburn's defense keying on number 18, Cobb in the Wildcat, looking to throw it this time. Only thrown it once previously and out of that formation this year, and nowhere to go this time. Antoine Carter and Craig Stevens combining to make the stop for the Tigers.
Well, this Kentucky offense a year ago down at Auburn ran the football, wore Auburn down, did a lot of wildcat in that game. But Randy Sanders right there, the offensive coordinator, looks like he's following the same blueprint. Run the football, use Cobb at quarterback.
Cobb had a big day last year against the Wildcats. Locke with nowhere to go, trying the right side of that line, and that's going to be a loss on the play, plus a flag. That last update could have only been the velvet tones of Wendy Nix. I'm sorry, Wendy. Back to you.
Mark, that's quite all right. It's an SEC smorgasbord across our family of networks on ESPNU, Vanderbilt, and Eastern Michigan. And over on ESPN, LSU up 3-0 over the Florida Gators.
All right, Wendy, 5.5 minutes to go here. Heartline fires a strike complete. Out beyond the 30 to the 32 to Matt Rourke. 6'5 junior picks up 12 on the play. Still going to be short of the first down, so Kentucky will have to punt a 3-and-out on their second offensive possession. Ryan Tedlochka coming into punt.
Kentucky has struggled on punt coverage this year. Last week, Ole Miss, a 73-yard punt return. Been an area of concern right here for Kentucky. Punt coverage.
When Darius Carr staying at his own 30, Auburn comes after it a little bit. And Tedlochka gets off a low line drive that takes a very favorable Wildcat bounce all the way down to the 20-yard line. A 49-yard punt, nothing on the return. Auburn 80 yards away. Football inside Commonwealth Stadium, but a lot to do here in this part of Kentucky.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Volvo, who believe that life is better lived together. Volvo for life. And Sprint, the Now Network.
Talked about there being a lot to do in the Lexington area. Always take a tour of the Woodford Reserve here, one of the many distilleries making bourbon here in Kentucky. It's named after Bourbon County, Kentucky. Estimates that about 95% of the world's bourbon made right here. First down and 10 for the Tigers. Starting from their own 20. And that's the freshman, Michael Dyer, still on his feet. A breakaway run across midfield into Kentucky territory. And you see why he was the number one rated tailback out of high school last year.
Watch Auburn pull the two guards around. Big number 66, Mike Berry. Number 57, Baron Isom. You're going to see those offensive linemen from Auburn, a lot of pulling. You know, a lot of these spread teams are just zone blocking, where you see all the linemen just kind of working in unison. Auburn will pull those linemen a lot.
Here's Newton. Plenty of time to pass. Has his receiver at the 41-yard line. That's the tight end, Philip Lutzenkirchen. A 12-yard gain and another first down.
8-12.
Offense gets the ball to the official. They want to snap that ball less than 5 seconds after it's been spotted. Dyer again behind those pulling offensive linemen. Across the 35 to the 34. Randy Moss back in Minnesota and Brett Favre returning to New York on ESPN's Monday Night Football. Vikings Jets. That is a juicy game right there with a lot of headlines. 8:30 p.m. Eastern time. It all starts at 7 Eastern on Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's. Second down and 3 coming up. Fannin in the backfield. Play fake on the post. Incomplete in the end zone, intended for Carr. No flags on the play.
Well, Randall Burden bounced back after that pass interference. I'm not sure right there. You know, he never actually looked back for the football, Randall Burden. A lot of times you get the flag on that. Winston Guy also back in coverage.
Boy, Kentucky trying to run people on the field as the ball was being snapped. They got caught getting a personnel group on. And that's going to be a flag against the Wildcats. The catch made by Cody Burns. Picks up four.
Look at Steve Brown, the defensive coordinator from Kentucky, on the sidelines. Always difficult to try to match personnel. Gus Malzahn will go ahead and snap that football if he sees guys running on the field.
Does anyone want to be a defensive coordinator anymore?
It is hard. Just sit and watch college football all day today.
Gus Malzahn of Springdale, Arkansas.
Defense. The 12th player had not made it off the field before the snap. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot results in the first down.
It almost looked like that fire drill with LSU and Tennessee last week at the end of the game.
Well, it is really difficult. I mean, you look at Kentucky, and I'm not sure at some point the NCAA Rules Committee is going to come back and kind of reassess this. You're supposed to give the defense time to line up. Now, I know it's the coach's responsibility and the player's responsibility to get out there, but I don't think anybody wants to see people just trick people in college football. I mean, get lined up and let's play.
Here's Fannin. Lane on the outside. Got a nice block from Byron Isom to pick up six.
Yeah, you said it. These big offensive guards, 66 and 57, are fun to watch. It's hard to find big guys like that, except for Cam Newton, that can run that fluidly. I'm impressed with these offensive linemen of Auburn.
Second and four. Newton with the fake. Out of the backfield, that's complete. Zachary. And Terrell Zachary with his first reception of the game. That's the team's fastest wide receiver, who picks up 12.
They bring Burden, Terrell Zachary, in motion. Kentucky kind of leaves him alone out there in the flat.
And Fannin gets the carry this time. Picks up a couple of yards down to the 8-yard line. And the pace here is incredibly brisk by, you know, the Auburn Tigers.
Not only pace, but diversity of plays. Think of all the different looks that Gus Malzahn has given Steve Brown in this Kentucky defense. Now they're an empty no-backs with a 6'6", 250-pound quarterback back in the backfield.
Something doesn't sound fair about that. Newton, touchdown.
Touchdown, Auburn.
Like clockwork, the Auburn Tigers move the ball down the field. And that's his second rushing touchdown tonight.
He just glides. He just kind of toys with you. I'm waiting for him to turn on the afterburner.
How much does he look like Terrell Pryor out there with the with the stride and the arm?
Yeah, Terrell Pryor in a quarterback run scheme. I mean, this kid gets to carry the ball just about every down.
It's a long way from Gainesville to Blinn Junior College to the flats of Auburn, Alabama. You're watching the SEC on ESPN.
Dish Network brings you the ultimate football season with Dish Network's exclusive Gridiron Games. Draft your team every week and face off against other Dish Network customers with Snap Draft. Or play Team Pick'em and pick the winners from Sunday's action. Compete to win over $70,000 in prizes. Even better, it's free to play and only for Dish Network customers. Visit dish.com/gridiron to play Dish Network's Gridiron Games. Only from Dish Network.
Support those who fuel our freedom. Receive a military support pin when you visit a Victory dealer and donate holiday care package items for the troops. Locate your dealer at victorymotorcycles.com.
Welcome back, everyone, to the SEC on ESPN. Auburn with a 7-point lead. You're looking at Cam Newton, all 6'6", 250 pounds of him, Bob. And if you're a quarterback, I guess it does pay a little bit to be tall. Size does matter some.
Well, first thing I think of is back when these guys were playing Little League football, somebody had the foresight to keep these big guys at quarterback. You know, there's such a temptation when you have a big, big guy to make them a tight end or make them a defensive end or up your alley, make them a power forward.
Hey, nice
so
wing
somebody somewhere had the foresight to take Mallett, Pryor, and Cam Newton and say, you know what, you're a big athlete, but you're also an athlete that can throw the football. We're going to keep you at quarterback.
Question now begs for Kentucky defensively. How do they slow that juggernaut down? Move the ball 8 plays, 80 yards, in a little over 3 minutes for the touchdown. This is Cobb from the two. Randall Cobb brought down at the 30-yard line.
Kind of a scenario, I guess, if you look at big Cam Newton. Think about Magic Johnson. Someone had the foresight early to keep him at point guard.
6'8", 6'9".
Exactly. But you know what? The game's changed so much that a big guy that can run like this and spread the field, what a weapon.
Yeah, he's not just big. He can move, like you said.
You're not licking your chops to hit the quarterback when you play defense against a guy like that.
Hartline completes the pass out to the 37-yard line. Nice catch by Cobb. Well, Chris Berman is your host for ESPN's two-hour pregame show, Sunday NFL Countdown. Tom Jackson, Keyshawn Johnson, Mike Ditka, Chris Carter, with insiders Chris Mortensen and Adam Schefter give you all the analysis, insight, and news from the NFL. Sunday NFL Countdown, presented by IBM on ESPN, Sunday at 11 a.m. Eastern time. Cobb now in the Wildcat. Fakes the handoff to Locke. And Auburn seems to have figured out this formation a little bit.
Well, I'm a little bit surprised that against Auburn you run this much Wildcat, because I think this defense has seen a bunch of Wildcat in practice against their own offensive team. You look at Ted Roof right there. I think he's done an outstanding job at Auburn. I know their statistics haven't been as good as what Auburn fans have seen in the past, but they're building this defense back up. This guy right here is really a good coach.
And that's going to be the end of the first 15 minutes of play. Gus Malzahn's team leading 14-7, looking for its sixth consecutive win to open the season. We'll be back to Lexington right after this. Welcome back to ESPN2's College Football Primetime, part of the SEC on ESPN. Lexington, Kentucky. Hey, got to recognize the guy in the middle at tailgate party prior to the game. Down to the bottom corner, the left, former head coach Rich Brooks. Bob, I think he's a little less stressed now that he's stepped away from the job a little bit. Although he looks like he's got the game face on there, enjoying time with his family.
Great guy. Did an incredible job here at Kentucky. Four straight bowl games, four straight winning seasons. I think the first time in school history that's happened.
Yes, sir. Third and six. Hartline throws it up. And incomplete, a flag thrown back at the 21-yard line in the vicinity of Nick Fairley and the quarterback, Mike Hartline.
Well, Nick Fairley, number one in the Southeastern Conference tackles for losses. He has 5 sacks. We'll see him at the top of the screen.
Boy. And the verdict is?
That was close. That was very close. I mean, the emphasis, I guess, on protecting the quarterback.
I don't know. It is football.
I can tell by the tone of your voice you don't agree with that call.
Not quite. Raymond Sanders in the backfield now. He takes the handoff. Sanders down into Auburn territory. Let's check in with Wendy in the studio.
Chris L. Rucker making noise against Denard Robinson. Don't give him the Heisman just yet. Picked off by Rucker. And for the first time since 65, 66, and 67, Michigan State has defeated Michigan three consecutive years.
All right, Wendy, they're talking about the Heisman coming down to the Plains here with Cam Newton at quarterback. Right now, though, it's the Wildcats with the football. This is Sanders again. Stopped up right at midfield by Josh Bynes, middle linebacker, number 17. 1 yard gain on the play. Bynes, the guy that keeps everyone straight, makes the calls at linebacker for the Tigers defensively.
Boy, and what a great young man Josh Bynes is. You know, we had a chance to talk to him on the telephone this week. He's the guy that gets everybody lined up. Ted Roof told me the most aware guy he has ever coached, Josh Bynes.
On third and seven, complete, but short of the first down. That was number 16, LaRod King, making the catch. Zach Etheridge there immediately to stop him.
Zach Etheridge. You talk about guys in college football bouncing back from adversity. He had a neck fracture last year. Neck fracture, missed the last four games. No hesitation at all by Zach Etheridge.
Dlatchka going to stand at his own 40 to punt this one. Let it bounce at the five and through the back of the end zone. Quindarius Carr lets it go, which proves to be a good decision. Tigers will start first and 10 from their own 20-yard line. Back with more right after this. Back in Lexington, Kentucky, it's the SEC on ESPN, and you're looking at Kentucky's defensive coordinator, Steve Brown, a guy under siege right now. Well, at least his defense is, Bob. How do they slow this thing down from Auburn?
First of all, you got to get lined up because you're going to get the quick no huddle. Second of all, you have to stay in your gaps because number two will find a crack.
Here he comes, and he's found a huge gaping hole over the right side. And it looks like he got another Auburn Tiger first down, 11 yards on the play for Cam Newton.
When we look at Steve Brown, you know, last week they gave up 42 points at Ole Miss. But Ole Miss only had 301 yards. You know, Kentucky turned the ball over three times in the first half. The only game they've played really poorly, they gave up 48 to Florida. But Florida has had their number, it seems like, forever.
Florida does that to a lot of teams. Newton comes underneath, completes the pass to Fannin, who is a good receiver, picks up 4 yards on the play. Auburn Tigers will get the ball to the official right after the play and do it again. They practice it. Second down and six coming up for Auburn. Three receivers to the bottom of your screen. This is about as deep as you'll see them go in the play clock. 6 seconds to go. And Newton in space, which means Kentucky is in trouble. Another first down for the Tigers. Collins Uku makes the stop, but Newton glides his way to 22 yards. A loping, long, angular stride by Cam Newton.
Well, you mentioned Uku right there. Defensive end, the big sophomore. Boy, you had better stay disciplined and you better stay home.
Cam
because
Newton.
He's reading.
Yeah.
You know, if you close it all, he's going to keep the football.
Cam Newton's already run the ball 7 times for 80 yards and a couple of touchdowns. Little heat coming this time by the defense. He slings it. What a play by Cam Newton. First and goal from the 9-yard line to Cody Burns. He threw it off balance.
Well, first of all, he should have been sacked by Anthony Mosley, the corner. You know, the corner comes on the blitz and is unblocked. I mean, that's a great feel for just feeling the corner blitz. And how about the throw? In the air. You talk about off the back foot. He wasn't off the back foot. He was in the air when he threw that football.
Newton hands it off this time to Bennett. And Bennett makes it down to the 5-yard line, a 4-yard gain.
Watch this play. I mean, he just feels the corner blitz coming. Now, this throw, that's an incredible throw right there. That shows strength. That is just flat-out strength.
250 pounds of arm behind that.
That might go in that early Heisman campaign reel, huh?
It's about time to get the Cam Newton bobbleheads ready. Cam Newton with his third rushing touchdown of the night. He said it would be a little selfish of me to start thinking or talking about a Heisman candidacy right now, but not anymore. Number 8 in the country, the Tigers rolling along, led by number 2. And it's 21-7 for the Auburn Tigers. The deuce is on the loose for the Tigers. And right now, there seems to be no stopping them. Back with more after this.
Beer and wine and cupcakes. I was doing the corporate grind like everyone else. But to be successful, I knew I had to be different. Ink, 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 ink. I mean, I love that card. It does things differently, too. Great customer service, going above and beyond to help me out as a small business. It's accepted in twice as many places around the world as American Express. And if I ever need to give my employees ink cards, they're free.
Make your mark with ink. Chase what matters. Go to chase.com/ink.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Ink, the new business card from Chase. Make your mark with Ink. And Carnival, fun for all for fun.
A lot of bounce in the steps of people in downtown Lexington, Kentucky, with Keeneland opening this week, and the World Equestrian Games as well in town, part of the festivities, and festivities by the Tigers, Bob.
I think these linebackers from Kentucky are having a hard time. They keep keying these running backs, but it's Cam Newton who carries the football. Watch those linebackers run out of there on the flow of those backs. Now it's Cam Newton that's coming north and south on you. You had better not take both linebackers and key the backs, because this guy already has 8 carries for 85 yards and 3 TDs.
He's tied his career high for touchdown runs already here with 10 minutes to go in the first half.
Somebody has to key that quarterback.
Cobb and Sanders back deep. No Derek Locke. Interesting to note that. This is Cobb. And Cobb takes it over the 25. Let's kick it back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you very much. LSU in Florida over on ESPN. Jordan Reed here from a yard out. This the result of the Gators picking off Jordan Jefferson. He's had 7 picks and 2 touchdowns. That made it 7-3, but then make that 3. Jefferson on the carry. LSU has the answer. This, a 10-7 ball game, 8 minutes to play in the second quarter.
All right, Wendy back here. Hartline completes the pass to Locke. And Locke brought down at about the 34. But after looking at that last highlight between Florida and LSU, there's some Gator fans that have to be wondering, what if Cam Newton was still? I mean, you can't help
it. You are right.
There's a boatload of possibilities.
You are right. I mean, Cam Newton starts out at Florida, goes to Blinn College. Now he's at Auburn. But you're exactly right. I mean, he'd look pretty good in that Gator uniform right now if you're a Gator fan.
Imagine they had the same scheme that they ran with Tim Tebow. Hartline to Cobb. Cobb stays on his feet and gets a first down out to the 43-yard line. Cobb with the nice catch. Quarterback receiver. Speaking of quarterbacks, what about Cameron Newton? Is he one of the elite players, maybe the top five players in the country right now?
I'll tell you what, he had me sold after the phone conversation on Wednesday with him. I mean, you see what he does on the field, but I mean, he is a tremendous young man. I mean, some of the things that he said on the phone, I was ready to give the Heisman right there.
Yeah, very impressive, well-spoken young man. Watt fumbles it. Still loose. And the Tigers get the ball. Craig Stevens, number 46, picks it up. And Ted Roof's defense comes up with the turnover.
Yeah, Kentucky, you look at Joker Phillips, the three turnovers at Ole Miss. They had two the week before at Florida, so that's six now in the last three games. Not sure who stripped this football out. Right there, someone came in. Josh Bynes, I think, number 17. Craig Stevens comes up with the recovery. Yeah, right there, that football stripped out. Boy, that is six turnovers now in the last two games and 8 minutes for Kentucky.
Here's Newton, keeps it. Lunging forward to the 45-yard line, picks up seven on the play. Cam Newton had a great quote when he was talking about one of his mentors and maybe his role model in life, talking about his father on the conference call with us a few days ago.
Yeah, he said, if I can be half the man that my dad is, I'll have been a tremendous success.
His dad, Cecil, playing a major role in his football career. Here's Fannin. Fannin got to the edge and got a bunch of yards. And another first down at the 28-yard line. Great blocking on the edge by the wide receiver, Cody Burns. A 17-yard gain.
You have to give a lot of credit. Cody Burns, a guy that starts out as a quarterback. They move him to wide receiver. I don't think he's caught a pass all year. But he's out there blocking for this football team.
Here's Dyer, the freshman, and he puts it on the ground. And the Tigers recover it. That's the type of night it's been for Auburn. The bounces have literally gone their way. We've already gotten the signal. Are they
going to talk this one over now?
One of the officials signaled Tiger football.
Freshman Michael Dyer coughed the football up.
Tell you, Dyer fumbling. That's the reason why he got his opportunity in the backfield, because Mario Fannin was fumbling early in the season.
I rule they return to the spot and fumble. Be second down.
Take one more look at this.
Yeah, Martavius Nellums right there is going to chop that football out of there.
Boy, Kentucky had three players there and couldn't get it. Offensive lineman Brandon Mosley, number 75, recovering for Auburn. Gives Newton another chance. Wide open at the five and incomplete. Intended for Philip Lutzenkirchen and knocked loose by Bailey. It was in his hands, but a better defensive play by Bailey.
Well, Cam Newton had a wide open receiver. You're going to watch right here. Watching him run down that field. Lutzenkirchen was open too, but he had a sure thing down the seam right there.
Third and two coming up. Batted down and the defense gets off the field. Tigers on the fringes of field goal range. Danny Trevathan knocks it down. And it's fourth down. In comes West Byron.
Steve Brown told us Danny Trevathan, he is Kentucky's best defensive player.
Say that he could be one of the best, maybe the best, before he's done. Here's Byron. This one going to come from about 38 yards out. He's 5 of 8 on the season. And West Byram makes it a 24-7 game for the Tigers. The Tigers able to capitalize on the fumble by running back Derek Watt. Back with more from Commonwealth Stadium after this. Welcome back, everyone, to the SEC on ESPN with number 8 Auburn looking to go 6-0 on the season and leading Kentucky 24-7. Hey, Jimmy Johnson has taken over the Chase lead, but Denny Hamlin and Kevin Harvick are hot on his heels. The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues with the Pepsi Max 400 in California on ESPN Sunday at 3 Eastern. Jimmy Johnson, 4 wins in the last 6 races in Fontana. Oh, this. Boy, you talk about Gene Chizik, Bob. A little over a year ago at this time, there were people wondering why exactly Jay Jacobs, the athletic director at Auburn, hired Gene Chizik. But Chizik remained a stalwart and confident in his abilities. He said, I wasn't looking for validation. As we look at Jacobs, Chizik said, I wasn't looking for validation because I knew everything about Auburn, for better or for worse.
Well, and you have to give Jay Jacobs so much credit. Looking past that 5-19 record at Iowa State, he knew Gene Chizik personally and knew he was a tremendous fit at Auburn.
Watt with a nice return beyond the 40. Well, Gene Chizik said that he wanted his players to know about the great history of the Auburn football program, not after they left, but while they were still on campus as players, and he wanted them to learn the creed. And there's a certain amount of pride that he put into making sure that each and every one of his players knew about that Auburn creed. First down and 10 for Kentucky. Hartline locked with the catch. Chopped out of bounds at about the 44. And a late flag on the play thrown after the gain of 11. On number 4, Zach Etheridge.
Well, Zach Etheridge, I don't love that call. I mean, Derek Locke was pulling up a little bit, but you got a guy that just ran 25 yards. It looked to me like Locke pulled up about 2 yards before he got to the sidelines. But again, this story of this kid coming off a fractured neck and just throwing his body around. Watch Locke pull up.
He's still in bounds when he got hit. Well, Kentucky quickly down at the 30-yard line of Auburn. Raymond Sanders in the backfield now behind Hartline. Complete down to the 22. Let's check in with Wendy back in the studio.
Mark, thank you very much. Oregon State leading Arizona, but they may have lost anyway. James Rogers, the receiving end of a long, what appeared to be touchdown pass, tackled in the end zone. He's now on the sidelines in crutches. That touchdown call back.
Ooh. All right, Wendy, back here, 2nd and 2. There's Sanders again. Sanders stopped up short of the first down, got a yard on the play. It'll be 3rd and 1 coming up. How important for Kentucky to get a score here?
Boy, critical. I mean, it's a 24-7 game. Joker Phillips, you know, a big 3-game homestand coming up right here. They're already 0-2 in the Southeastern Conference. You look at Randy Sanders, the offensive coordinator. I mean, they can score points. So as long as they can get a score here, stay positive, go into halftime with some momentum, they can score enough points to win this game.
Here's Cobb out of the Wildcat. Got to get a yard. Randall Cobb gets it done, and then some. Zach Etheridge in on another stop, but great move and a late flag on the play. Might have been the horse collar.
Yeah, I think they're going to get Zach Etheridge again, but
after the runs out of bounds, personal foul, number 4, defense.
And they're going to get a hit out of bounds again on Etheridge. But it isn't amazing about Randall Cobb. Well, let's take a look at it again over here on the sidelines. Looked like a horse collar to me.
Yeah.
I think maybe he meant horse collar.
Cobb throwing it back wide open. Touchdown, Kentucky. Allmiller. Seemingly just what the doctor ordered.
Well, the wide receiver that returns punts, returns kickoffs, he threw a touchdown pass on a fake field goal this year. Now he throws a touchdown from the Wildcat quarterback position.
Is that all? Extra point good. And Kentucky to within 10. Randall Cobb. There are a lot of famous Cobbs out there, but this one might be the most famous right now. You're watching the Welcome back, everyone, to Lexington, Kentucky. And the party just got cracking just a little bit more after that lost touchdown by Randall Cobb on the pass. Well, time now for our playing favorites brought to you by Pizza Hut. Randall Cobb, once again, a key cog in what they did offensively on that last drive. You know, Jeff, pardon me, Mike Hartline has been quietly very efficient the last couple of times that he's been on the field. And here's how the drive ended. To a wide open tight end, Jordan Allmiller making his first career touchdown catch.
This guy, Mr. Football, state of Tennessee, class 2A. Tennessee didn't offer him until real late. Again, a guy that plays with a chip on his shoulder. You know, we met him the other day. He didn't hesitate about saying that. That is his motivation.
He likes being perturbed. It wasn't the word that he used, but it was something along those lines. Washington, 5 yards deep. And the Tigers are going to start off on their own 20-yard line. Let's go back to Wendy in the studio. What's up, Wendy?
Mark, thank you very much. We've got another update. Florida LSU again over on ESPN. Trey Burton, the Gators' new offensive weapon, puts it in the end zone. 14-10, Florida on top. Just under 3 minutes left to go in the first half. And over on ABC, Florida State, a 7-0 advantage over number 13, Miami. Mark?
All right, thanks a lot, Wendy. Boy, is Les Miles the most scrutinized 5-0 coach in the country?
Yeah.
Michael Dyer in the backfield takes the handoff from Newton with nowhere to go. That Kentucky defense, they get something done here. It'd be a nice way to end the first half. Trevathan with the stop on the play. You know, we talked about Trevathan's toughness last season. He played with a broken hand for weeks and wasn't even aware of it. So they could be, he could be one of the all-time best before he leaves. Second and 11, McCaleb brought down for a loss. Snead making the stop and a loss of 4.
Yeah, Ronnie Snead unblocked. Good job inside out tackle on McCaleb. Momentum has switched, Mark. Huge third down right here for Kentucky.
And the Wildcats have to call a timeout. Unable to get guys on the field. On 3rd and 14, a pivotal juncture here in the first half for the Wildcats defensively. We'll get more on the other side. Here in Lexington, Kentucky, one of the shrines of basketball, Rupp Arena. Inside, lots of hardware, lots of trophies. And the venerable late Adolph Rupp. And all those championships on the sidelines as head coach of the Wildcats. And Wildcats football program finding success and riding the coattails of the basketball program, bringing recruits in often because they want to witness Wildcat madness on the court. 3rd and long.
Well, Auburn sees man-to-man coverage by Kentucky. It's just bump and run, locked on with a free safety back in the middle of the field.
Newton. What a catch at the 48-yard line. Darvin Adams, their go-to guy, comes up with a big catch for 34 yards.
Darvin Adams.
Oh, there's a flag down on the play at the 17-yard line. Flag all the way back at the 17.
How big is this penalty?
After the play, personal foul, number 75 on offense.
Brandon Mosley, the right tackle for the Tigers, the perpetrator. 15-yard
penalty from the succeeding spot in first and 10.
So the first down stands.
Well, what an effort, first of all, by Darvin Adams. Caught 60 passes last year.
Now, interestingly enough, that's a highly motivated Darvin Adams, Bob. He was snubbed from the All-SEC first and second teams preseason.
Good job of just isolating one-on-one coverage, putting the football up to Darvin Adams, letting your wide receiver make a play. That was a key third and 14 missed opportunity for Kentucky right there.
About 3.5 minutes to go in the first half. Newton hands it off to Fannin. Check that. That was McCaleb who gets a yard, stopped by Trevathan. Ontario McCaleb, his exploits on campus and his quickness, a subject of Auburn folklore. I'll tell you more about that after this play. How fast is he, you wonder? We'll tell you how fast.
Well, he jumped on the scene last year as a freshman. First two games, over 100 yards. I know where you're going with that story. I'm not sure I'm buying that story still, but.
Set up a little screen pass. And this is McCaleb. How fast is he? Fast enough to get the first down all the way down to the 40-yard line. Well, I was referring to the fact that some of his teammates said that last year when he was a freshman on campus, walking along campus, he saw a squirrel come down out of a tree, bet his teammates that he could catch it, and he did catch it with his hands. Not a net or any other device. He caught it with his hands. That's quick. That's fast.
Well, Auburn in an unbalanced line.
As Newton keeps it himself. And drilled at the 41 by Trevathan.
Tell you what, Trevathan's playing a heck of a football game.
Let's check in with Wendy.
Mark, thank you. Coming up on the Outback Steakhouse Halftime Report, the Alabama Crimson Tide rolls in the wrong direction. The Paul Bunyan Trophy, not the axe, stays put. Plus an update on the Seminoles and Gators. Todd McShay and Robert Smith join me at the half. Mark?
All right, Wendy, that Paul Bunyan Trophy's been in a long time in East Lansing. Newton. And this is where he can really be lethal. Gliding. Cam Newton put his hat down, and it's first and goal at the 5-yard line, and he delivered the blow on Randall Burton 35 yards later.
And the amazing thing, how patient he is in the pocket. Watch him sit in here, and then run. I guess when you're 6'6", 260, there's no need to panic. I mean, he waits so long until he just escapes out of that pocket. And then he's going to lower the boom.
Do you want him sliding instead, Bob?
He told us he grew up as a linebacker. He said he wants to deliver the blow,
okay,
not take the blow.
All right.
I mean, he's not a normal quarterback now. 6'6", 260, you're allowed to put that head down.
Keeps it himself. Oh, what a sidestep. Down to the 3-yard line, picked up a couple. I was just thinking about self-preservation and keeping the offense intact with him staying healthy.
I know this. Give him the green light to carry the football, but go back to that third down and 14 conversion to Darvin Adams. That took the wind out of this Kentucky defense. They had a tremendous opportunity right there.
Saw the impressive numbers, meanwhile, from quarterback Cam Newton.
Hey, who's playing better than this guy? I would have said maybe the Michigan quarterback, Denard Robinson. But after today, I don't know.
There's your answer. Newton with his fourth touchdown, a career high. And the meter is still running. And you can strike up the Heisman campaign right now.
I mean, another just little misdirection, predetermined quarterback run, and that guy's trying to figure this out wearing that Trevathan jersey.
I'm not sure that Newton has been touched on either of his four touchdown runs.
That's impressive.
We got to get a cam. Let's take a look at our Amway positive performance. Who do you think this is going to center around?
Oh, do you think it's this guy?
Cam Newton, you know, we talked about Bob, the influence of his father in his life, a minister. And we said that he told us on a conference call, if he could be half the man that his dad, Cecil, was, then he'll have really done something.
You know, the other thing he said, you were talking about the Auburn man, Gene Chizik, with that creed. He also told us on the phone, I asked him, how many times are you comfortable carrying the ball? He said, whatever it takes for Auburn to win, because I'm an Auburn man. And the other thing the coaches said about him, you know, Auburn's been behind a lot this year against Clemson, against South Carolina. He's so positive with his teammates. You know, he never gets down, keeps those guys up. I can see why Blinn College in Brenham, Texas, won the national championship last year with Dennis Francione's son as the head coach.
Yep. Took a year there as an intermediary stop after his transfer from Florida. And the kicker return comes out to the 33. That was Ridge Wilson. Let's take a look at these five quarterbacks, notable QBs right now. Which of those guys is playing better than Cam Newton, at least statistically right now? I'm not sure anyone is.
Boy. And, I mean, the total focus of the offense on him. Denard Robinson's the only other guy, right, with the total focus on him. You know, it's going to come down to Auburn, how many games they win, and can this guy stay healthy, right?
Yep.
He's going to have a legitimate shot.
Of those five quarterbacks, only two are undefeated. Here's Locke with a nice spin move out to the 40-yard line. Boise State, the only other team that is undefeated.
Well, Kentucky with two timeouts. Let's see if we can at least get a field goal out of this right here.
Second and three coming up. Heartline complete. That's King, Lerod King, with the first down into Auburn territory at about the 41. A nice gain of 17.
Clock management. Such a huge issue, as you mentioned, after the LSU Les Miles debacle last week.
Heartline completes his 13th consecutive pass. Hey, quietly, the other guy, quote-unquote, Mike Heartline, is 13 of 13.
Great point. And because Randall Cobb's played some Wildcat quarterback, that's kept the attention off Mike Heartline.
Second and four coming up. Kentucky with a couple of timeouts remaining.
Here's where all those scenarios of time clock management. Two timeouts, 20 seconds, second down.
That line, 14 passes complete in a row to Cobb, who steps out of bounds with another first down. 14 seconds to go.
Talk about ups and downs. About Mike Heartline's career.
Yeah.
He's been booed in this stadium as a sophomore. Comes back last year, has the knee injury, misses a good part of the season. Wins the job in camp. Really a game manager. You know, they do so much checking at the line of scrimmage.
Kentucky trying to put some points on the board before this half comes to an end.
One of the best things about Auburn is the creed. It talks about having a spirit that is not afraid. It inspired me to research early signs of autism.
I've been inspired to develop software that helps man's best friend detect explosives and save lives.
It inspired me to work with my faculty mentor researching the causes of obesity, which could help change lives. I believe in Auburn and love it.
Hey, this was a scene last week between LSU and Tennessee. a frenzied finish, clock management coming into focus, Bob.
Crazy. And because of this, I think everybody's seen this clip right here. Tennessee caught with 13 players on the field. Les Miles beat up because he's trying to change personnel. The point becomes this. Gene Chizik Sunday morning after this game, the Auburn coach, takes this tape, this specific series right here, and shows it to his football team. Every coach in the country keeping a reel on clock management.
Hartline wide open and dropped by Randall Cobb. And that hurts their clock management plan now. With 10 seconds to go, he was 14 of 14 before that incompletion, Hartline was.
And one thing, Mark, just to finish up, you don't ever want to be tagged a poor clock management coach. And that's why these coaches are paranoid about end of the half, end of the game, clock management. I think it's a great idea by Gene Chizik.
Does Kentucky have two plays called right now with 10 seconds to go? I mean, what do they think?
Well, Kentucky with two timeouts is in pretty good shape, really.
Second and 10 for Hartline.
Get out of bounds.
And Locke does just that at about the 12-yard line with 3 seconds to go.
You have to kick the field goal. Anything under 5 seconds, you're playing with fire, trying to get one more play. 3 seconds, it's a no-brainer. That's an excellent drive right there by Kentucky.
If not for that drop pass by Cobb, who knows? And in comes Craig McIntosh. He's 4 of 6 on the season. And he knocks that one through. So Kentucky narrows the lead to 2 touchdowns to 14 points. As they try to make it 2 in a row against Auburn. All right, it's 31-17 at the break. Right now, let's head to the Outback Steakhouse halftime report. Well, Stadium, it's all part of the SEC on ESPN. And right now, Auburn leads the Wildcats, the home team, 31-14. Hello, everybody. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey. Thanks for coming aboard. You know, Gene Chizik, the head coach of Auburn, said coming into this game, hey, we're 5-0 now. We were 5-0 last year at this point. We're going to find out just much how much further ahead we are than we were a season ago. And right now, the answer seems to be pointing in the right direction for them.
No question. I mean, what, last year Kentucky beat them 21-14
right
at Auburn at the same point in the season. The biggest difference, number 2, Cam Newton. I mean, obviously, 260-some yards offense in the first half just for number 2. And defensively, I think they do have more depth. I do think they're improved. I'm not sure how much, though. This Kentucky football team can score enough points to win this game. The question is, can Kentucky stop or slow down Auburn?
Well, Auburn's going to get the football to start the second half here. Washington on the kickoff return. Amon Washington can be brought down at about the 21-yard line. And now tonight's game track brought to you by John Hancock. And Randall Cobb got the party going early for the Wildcats along with Locke.
Yeah, I don't know if you're going to see another college football game this year where the impact players are so defined. You know, Cobb and Locke for Kentucky, and then obviously Cam Newton for Auburn. Just so much of the offense on those three players in the first half. And this guy, I mean, you talk about a first half, 132 rushing, 129 passing.
Newton on the option, tosses it to Fannin. And Mario Fannin out to the 28-yard line. A pickup of 6 on the play. You know, the other guy, Hartline. Mike Hartline hasn't put up some, he put up some good stats too tonight.
That's amazing. Talk about quietly. I mean, Mike Hartline, 14 for 15, 131. Just get him the ball and don't fall behind anymore on if you're Kentucky. They can move it.
Fannin moves it across the 30. That's going to be enough for the first down for the Tigers on this, their first possession of the second half.
And another guy having a great night is number 22, Danny Trevathan. I mean, he has made some tackles on defense for Kentucky.
Newton with all day to throw. And he's picked off at the 40-yard line by Winston Guy.
ball underthrown, trying to get it to Emery Blake. Winston Guy, Steve Brown told us, as talented as any player Kentucky has, he's been inconsistent. A little bit of a pump fake. I mean, look at the, threw that ball, didn't really step into where he was throwing that ball, right? He stepped down the field, kind of threw it off to his right.
Kentucky's fourth interception of the season, and prior to that possession, the Tigers had scored on every possession in the first half. See what the Wildcats can do with this turnover. Hartline, a strike complete to King. First down Wildcats at the Auburn 40-yard line, and a gain of 22.
Kentucky continuing. Remember, they finished the first half with an excellent drive, had the field goal, keeping the momentum they had right there at the end of that first half.
Fumble on the snap, and Hartline falls at it at the 43-yard line, so they'll lose 2 or 3 yards on that play. Kentucky in a familiar spot in comparison to last year's game at Auburn when they trailed late for a couple of big plays by Derek Locke and Randall Cobb.
I teased Joker Phillips yesterday about that gray hair we saw kind of popping out of there.
Well, he said it started at Notre Dame.
Well, he's right. He's right.
Second and 12. The bootleg and upfield. Incomplete, batted away nicely by Damon Washington, intended for Randall Cobb. And it'll be third and long now for Kentucky.
Boy, what a great job by Damon Washington of just focusing on the football and stripping Randall Cobb. Watch right here. Never looks back to the ball, but total concentration on Randall Cobb's hands and just strips that football out. That's an excellent play.
Yeah, Cobb had that in his hands, caught. And Hartline wants to think it over. And perhaps a moment of uncertainty. It's third and 12 for the Kentucky Wildcats, seeing what they can do after that interception. 9:30 Eastern time, bottom of the hour here in Lexington, Kentucky. Gene Chizik's team with the lead by 14 points. Here's what's happening now. Auburn undefeated at 5-0 for the second year in a row. And for the fourth time in the last 7 years coming into this game. Coming up, Davy Jones Locker. We're going to break down the numbers, analyze and paralyze the numbers. Bob Davy going to take you inside our treasure chest of stats this week. Explain the significance. And later, the state of Kentucky trying to make a statement.
I'll tell you, one statement was made today. What a beautiful day. What, about 80 degrees today? A lot of buzz with the, help me out here, the World Equestrian Games. We had the British National Equestrian Team at our hotel.
Lodging. They're rather sedate, I might add, you know.
Well, it's like the Olympics of horse.
Yeah, it's a good thing it wasn't the British rugby team, is what I'm trying to say. Yeah. Third and 12 coming up. Here's Locke. Not enough for the first down. Inside the 40 to the 38, and a chorus of boos now raining down on the Wildcats. And it looks like Derek Locke is still on the turf. Zach Etheridge made the hit on the play. Locke has had a tough night physically. We saw him getting worked over earlier, his neck being attended to by one of the athletic trainers on the sideline, and now they tend to him again on the field.
Well, obviously, when the call doesn't work on third and long and it's a draw, they're going to boo. But more importantly, Derek Locke down on that field. You're going to watch right here the hit.
Looked rather harmless. Of course, that's from the camera's view. We're going to take a short break and come right back. Back in Lexington, Kentucky, under the lights, I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davy. Derek Locke, starting tailback for the Kentucky Wildcats, being worked on by the athletic trainers there. They're tending to his right arm. Clock was shaken up on that 3rd-and-12 drop play that came up about 7 yards short of the first down. Tedlochka with his third punt of the night. And this one will carry into the end zone and come back out to the 20, 39 yards and all. Well, hey, Jimmy Johnson has taken over the Chase lead, but Denny Hamlin and Kevin Harvick are hot on his heels. The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues with the Pepsi Max 400 in California on ESPN Sunday at 3 Eastern.
But Bob, just to go back to the World Equestrian Championships, it's
The Olympics of, you know, dressage and then the horse jumping thing where they go over the gates.
Yeah.
Just clear that.
I wish you would have helped me when I went down the path of the Olympics of horse. You could have jumped in there and bailed me out a little bit there with that explanation.
I guess I'm trying to figure it out myself. I think it's like the decathlon or, yeah, like you said, the Olympics for horses. Vannon, Forward Progress, going to go out to the 21-yard line. Well, the World Equestrian Games are the equivalent of the World Cup, actually, for equestrian sports. And the games are comprised of the World Championships for 8 equestrian sports. So, hey, 16 days of competition. Athletes from over 50 countries all here in the Lexington area. So, Lexington, the focal point of the horse universe. Pass incomplete to Darvin Adams, and we won't be talking any more equestrian for the rest of the night.
It looked like Cam Newton starting to guide that ball a little bit. Those last two throws, and this thing, you got to talk about this.
What
Gus
is
Malzahn and his card color numerical combos over there on the sideline.
That's what they're looking at
Now. The offense, all the checks come from the sideline. Compared to Kentucky, well, Mike Hardline makes all the checks himself at the line of scrimmage, but it's an intricate process.
Candy. Pass incomplete, and it's 3 and out for the Tigers offensively. Pass intended for Terrell Zachary. And this is going to be the first punt of the night for Ryan Shoemaker. And that's a victory for Steve Brown's defense.
Anytime Cam Newton throws it, Steve Brown's probably a little bit more confident than if Cam Newton runs it. How about this punt shift formation?
Randall Cobb standing at his own 40. And Cobb's going to get a chance, but they blow it dead.
Penalty marker down.
A flag down on the play.
Before the snap.
Gonna do it again on 4th and 14 now.
Different punter in the game, number 30, Stephen Clark. Tell you what, the biggest quarterback in the country in Cam Newton, maybe the biggest punter. It's 6'5", 232. It's his first punt ever in college football. Let's see what happens.
It's off a high spiral. Rather short, though. And Cobb takes the fair catch in Auburn territory. A 32-yard boot, 1st and 10. There it is. We talked about it. The World Equestrian Games. Bob Davey going to get those the hat and the boots on and try and get that pony over those barriers, right? Back after this.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Taco Bell, Think Outside the Bun, and Audi, Truth in Engineering.
You got to love the sport of Kings. Keeneland just opened this weekend. It's the thoroughbred racing in the industry, what Wall Street really is to investing, what St. Andrews is to golf, and what Hollywood is to movies. Big part of the region here. 1st and 10. Did I tell you my grandfather owned horses back in Jamaica?
You did tell me.
Okay.
That. But kind of a little bit of a lull offensively right here, both teams. But another great opportunity for Kentucky. You know, Kentucky's defense gets the turnover on Auburn's first series. 3 and out on the second series.
Loss of 3 on the play, and Hey, Derek Locke still on the bench. Donald Russell in the backfield now behind Hartline. Russell couldn't make the catch and it's ruled incomplete. And in a blink of an eye, it's third and long, third and 13 coming up. Still working on Derek Locke on the sidelines. It appeared they were tending to his right arm. Not sure exactly which part of his right arm. It seemed to be where they were focusing on. Cobb lined up to the slot on the top of your screen. Hartline over the middle. Little contact. And that's going to be pass interference against the Tigers. Pass incomplete at the 38. It was intended for Lerod King. And Mike McNeil appeared to get there a little bit early.
Yeah, he did. No question, Mike McNeil. Contact before the football.
Pass interference, number 26, defense. The penalty is a first down at the spot of foul.
With Derek Locke on the sidelines, you know, Raymond Sanders, young freshman running back out of Stone Mountain, Georgia. He's built a lot like Locke, you know, the 5'7", 5'8", type guy that's very explosive.
See what Hartline can do here. Raymond Sanders behind him. Little receiver screen to Cobb. Cobb with a couple of slick moves down to the 30-yard line. Now let's take a look at our FaceTime profile brought to you by Edward Jones. And here's what Joker Phillips had to say on being second guest. I heard Coach Calipari say the other day, he said, you guys, fans, cheer, I'll coach, and the players will play. I wish one day I could say that. I will have arrived when I can say that.
Yeah, you start telling those fans what they can and can't do.
Right.
You better have some wins under your belt before you start being too strong.
There's Cobb out of the Wildcat. And he tiptoes out of bounds. Joker Phillips for several years was the head coach in waiting until Rich Brooks, the former head coach, retired, which he did last year. But Joker Phillips, prior to taking over as head coach, Bob, has gotten used to being the head coach by carrying out some of the head coach coaching duties.
Exactly. In that role as head coach in waiting, did a lot of speaking, did a lot of things around the state, did a lot of recruiting, which he's always been a great recruiter.
First down and 10 for the Wildcats. Russell in the backfield. Allmiller in motion. Russell brought down right near the line of scrimmage. Might have gotten a yard on the play with 9.5 minutes to go here in the third quarter. Nick Fairley making the stop for the Tigers.
We talked yesterday with Joker, and you know, it's all going to come down to winning Southeastern Conference games, and that sounds pretty obvious, but you know, they've been 7-6, 7-6, 8-5, 8-5 the last 4 years. They took some strides last year, beat Georgia, beat Auburn, both on the road. Winning Southeastern Conference games is the key, and they've got an opportunity tonight. I mean, they can jump back in this football game right here.
Completes the pass, to speak to your point. Completion of 4 yard. Joker Phillips said that being in a basketball school isn't a bad thing, or something that's perceived to be a basketball school, because recruits will ask to come on their visits for football during a basketball game and see the John Walls and the DeMarcus Cousins of the Kentucky basketball side of the family.
Exactly. I mean, that's a positive, having such a high-profile basketball program. I see no negative in that at all.
Third and 5. And timeout. Just under 8.5 minutes to go. Back to Lexington right after this.
Imagine if you could keep your engine as close as possible to factory clean. Pennzoil Ultra, a revolutionary synthetic oil that takes clean where it's never been before. Nothing feels like a factory clean engine, and nothing keeps you closer to factory clean than Pennzoil Ultra Motor Oil.
Under the Lights in Lexington, and Monday Night Football with a great one this week. Randy Moss, the newest member of the Vikings, taking on Sanchez and the Jets. It all starts at 7 Eastern with Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's.
You watched Hard Knocks, right, on HBO?
Yeah.
How about John Connor, the fullback from Kentucky? What Rex Ryan called him, the Terminator.
Yep.
Gained a lot of national pub from that Hard Knocks, the old Kentucky fullback.
They say Moncel Allen, the fullback here, is as good a blocker as him.
Actually said better. Yeah.
Third and 5 for Hardline. Cobb with the catch and the touchdown. What doesn't Randall Cobb do?
Yeah, you're right.
The holder on extra points. And for him, the fourth touchdown catch this season, 10th of his career. And look at that, 31-24, the Wildcats back in it. What happened, Bob?
Well, they threw the quick slant against man-to-man coverage. Damon Washington led him inside. But, you know, strength in the weight room. This kid has strength on the football field. You know, Randall Cobb was a quarterback in high school at Alcoa, Tennessee. He's not the most bulked up looking guy when he walks in. I mean, we've had a bunch of guys, right, walk in and look more impressive physically. But this guy is very, very strong on the football field. And, I mean, he is a guy that has all the intangibles.
His high school team, Bob, you talked about him being from Alcoa, Tennessee, not that far from here, has won 34 consecutive games. And interesting that that guy right there, Cobb, he told us he was just a 2-star player with those rating systems they have by the various scouting services in high school. All of a sudden, Tennessee got in on his recruitment late, and he went up to a 3-star player.
And that still bothers him. I mean, right? We're sitting there yesterday, all the success he's had, that still bothers him, that 2-star deal. You know, Kentucky with 2 Mr. Tennessees on their football team, Ricky Lumpkin, the defensive lineman, Mr. Football in Tennessee as well.
Wilson watches it go out. And it's going to be right out to the 20-yard line. And, they've had a significant member of this staff at Kentucky make a huge contribution with their strength and conditioning. Rock Oliver has gotten these guys into what they feel is maybe the best shape they've been in a long time.
I think we're going to see a little Cam Newton running now. We've seen some Cam Newton passing the last couple series. I think you're going to see number 2 carrying that football.
Hands it off to McCaleb.
There's a flag on the play. Check that. Yeah, there is a flag.
Yeah.
Bailey making the stop.
Was there a flag? I thought Randall Burden got held, number 24. I guess they never threw the flag there.
Second down and 8. Newton stumbles and goes out to the 26. Wendy Nix, tell us what's up.
Mark, happy to do it. Thank you very much. An update from Oregon State and Arizona. Nick Grigsby here on the move for 41 yards. It's currently 23-20, but the big news out of this game, James Rogers, a leg injury in the first half. He came back out after the break on crutches in street clothes.
That's a pretty good revenge by Rogers. Kentucky blitzing, and Newton fires incomplete, intended for Emory Blake. Hey, Steve Brown's defense is getting it done now here in the third quarter.
Yeah, and that time he brought the blitz again. Trevathan, the linebacker, right up the gut. That's 3 3 and outs, really. The first series was an interception.
And a dangerous punt return man lurking back at the 35-yard line for Kentucky.
Again, the freshman punter, his second collegiate punt.
Clark gets off a moonshot. Cobb calls for the fair catch.
How cool is Randall
Cobb? Was he casual?
He's caught a few punts in his day, hasn't he?
Well, it's a metaphor for things that have been festering at the bottom of the ocean. Each week we open the locker and bring out something for discussion, a pertinent issue relevant to the game of football. This week in Davy Jones' locker, and Bob, this week we talk about the statistical category of passing efficiency. It's been described so many different ways. We have Auburn's quarterback Cam Newton, number two in the country in that category. Yeah. What is it? What's the significance?
Well, on Auburn's team, number one in passing efficiency in the country. What it is the NCAA come up with a stat where every team, every quarterback, regardless of scheme, is on a level playing field. In other words, it doesn't matter how many times you throw the ball or how many yards you gain. It's your efficiency when you throw it. And the first thing you see right there, completion percentage, touchdowns per throw, yards per throw, interceptions per throw. So it's not how many times, it's not how many yards total, it's per throw. So a guy like Cam Newton, who doesn't throw the football a whole lot, he's not penalized. It doesn't matter if you compare him to the kid at Texas Tech that throws it 60 times a game.
Okay.
It's all about efficiency when you throw it. And that's the most important thing. Did you get that?
Yes.
Yeah.
I was writing it down. Add up those four variables and work it all out. Well, the number 191.4, all you got to know, it's number two in the country.
Exactly.
Russell in the backfield beside Hartline. This is Russell out of the backfield making the catch at a first down at the 46-yard line. Bob, you, I'm sure, just enlightened a lot of coaches around the country who didn't know how they arrived at that number.
Well, you know what? I mean, statistics are things not every coach pays that much attention to. The passing efficiency is much more important than touchdown passes or total number of yards. It's, are you efficient when you throw it?
You speak about a guy who's a monument to efficiency. Hartline tonight hasn't misfired that much at all. Here's a little counter. Russell with a nice move. And another one. Russell breathing life into this Kentucky offense in the absence of Derek Locke.
Two missed tackles on that play. Aaron's Antoine Carter at the line of scrimmage, and then Aaron Savage, the safety downfield. There's one missed tackle. There's the second missed tackle in the open field.
Backs out of the offset eye. Here's Russell again. Eluded one tackler down to the 27-yard line. This all part of the big picture for the Wildcats. And, you know, they, under Joker Phillips, have adopted the credo that this year is all about Operation Win. He's had dog tags made up for all the players, or they've had them made up, and members of the staff, they wear them around, and there's even a pack of cards, playing cards. Second down and six. Cobb out of the Wildcat. Boy, Randall Cobb on the loose. He's going to tuck it and keep it. Operation Cobb. The magic of Randall Cobb continues.
Let me tell you about that two-star rating out of the state of Tennessee. Come on now. Just watch and enjoy this.
First and goal. Touchdown, Cobb. Randall Cobb with his second rushing touchdown of the night. You're laughing because
he's out of gas.
He's glad to be down on one knee.
Wow.
Getting a slight breather.
How about this kid, huh?
A two-star recruit. He told us earlier that he's sick of losing. He's been bothered by it all week. And he's playing as motivated or more motivated than any player on the field right now.
And he told us after the Ole Miss loss down in Oxford, Mississippi last week, he stayed in the locker room for a half an hour after the game and just sat there and thought how tired, how sick he is of losing and how he's going to use that as motivation all week.
The Auburn fans feeling like, hey, we've seen this movie before. This is how it went down last year on the Plains in Auburn when Cobb led them to the comeback. Tied at 31. A lot of the coaches here, they knew Cobb was special, Bob, when he became the first recruit to defeat former head coach Rich Brooks in ping pong in his office. That's when they knew he was real competitive.
Boy, it goes back to Kentucky's defense. First three series for Auburn. One turnover, two three and outs.
Washington scoops it up at the eight. And Damon Washington brings it out to about the 25-yard line. Well, Joker Phillips has these Kentucky cards. And you see it says UK football, Operation Win. Bob, it's a pretty good picture of Joker here, too. But what do you make of the whole big picture Operation Win, a credo, a vibe? What does it do for a program?
You know, I think there's a bunch of slogans, a bunch of clever things. I'm not sure that it really affects Randall Cobb.
Okay.
It's about Randall Cobb, and it's about this spirit of this football team. I mean, this guy right here, Randall Cobb, will inspire this football team a lot more than Operation Win. But let's find out right now about Cam Newton. They've been down. You take the Clemson game. You take the South Carolina game. He's struggling right now throwing the football, Cam Newton. But let's see him. We kind of anointed him in the first half of this game.
We sure did.
Right? Deservingly so. Let's see how he bounces back right now.
Well, you got to give a little bit of credit to Steve Brown's defense, because they have taken the Tigers' offense out of what they want to do, seemingly, here in the third quarter. But Caleb in the backfield takes the pitch. And a great open field tackle by number 5, 15, Martavius Nellens. A loss of three.
That's good defense. I mean, Martavius Nellens coming off a block, making a tackle.
Newton with time to pass. Drills it complete to number 81, Terrell Zachary. And that's going to be enough for another Auburn first down. A pickup of 17 on the play.
Has to be a big confidence booster right there. Cam Newton, plenty of time in that pocket. Steps up and just delivers that football. Quieted the crowd.
First down and 10 from the 39-yard line. Dyer in the backfield. Dyer takes the handoff. Dyer brought down after a gain of about 2 on the play.
So much at stake. Kentucky 0-2 already in the Southeastern Conference. Auburn with Alabama losing today. So much at stake early in this football season.
Second down and 8. Mark Jones along with Bob Davey here in Lexington, Kentucky, Commonwealth Stadium. Auburn trying to stay perfect on the year. Newton was red hot in the first half and throws a dart complete to Adams. Darvin Adams.
First and 10 from the 20-yard line for the Tigers.
Yeah, it was like Michael Bailey 41, like it was practice where you're not allowed to tackle the receiver. Watch 41, Michael Bailey. It's like he heard a whistle blow. That is really strange right there.
I'm quite sure what he was thinking. Wow.
As a result, Adams takes it down to the 20-yard line.
Yeah, big Cam Newton. We talked about bouncing back. He's bounced back throwing the football on this drive.
Sure has looked good, and Trevathan is off the field. Newton keeps it himself. Down to about the 13-yard line. Picks up 7 on the play. Talked about Cam Newton starting off at the University of Florida, transferring to Glenn Junior College, and then choosing Auburn over Oklahoma and Mississippi State.
You know Blue Bell ice cream? You've heard of Blue
yes.
Bell ice cream?
Yes.
Brenham, Texas, home of Glenn College.
Have you recruited Brenham in your time too?
Well, I lived right down the road in College Station.
Okay. Second and 3. Newton keeps it himself. He's the silencer, isn't he? Down to the 8-yard line. Winston Guy makes the stop, but Newton picked up 6.
Have you ever seen a guy run under control as much as he runs under control? And when you see Denard Robinson, he's going 100 miles an hour. Maybe it's because he's 6'6", 250, but he looks so smooth and fluid.
Dyer in the backfield. To the left of Newton, he drops it. And the Tigers pounce on the loose ball back at the 11-yard line with 1 minute to go now in the third quarter. Auburn has not scored in the period yet. Loss of 2 on the play, second and goal. It has been a contrast of halves for Auburn. Kentucky, due to their defense, back in this ball game here in the third period. Newton looking into the end zone. Broke a couple of tackles and put his hat down at the 8-yard line. Taylor Windham couldn't wrap him up. Well, here's the story of Cam Newton.
Yeah, and Taylor Windham, the guy who made the hit on Tebow last year.
Here was Newton at Glenn Junior College. After a year at Florida, transferred and won a national championship, Coach Franchione. Looking at third and goal now. And they're not going to get the playoff. And that's the end of the third period of play. Knotted at 31. And what about Steve Brown? He seems to have pressed the right button and pulled the right string. Cam Newton trying to solve that puzzle when we come back to the fourth, right after this. Welcome back, everyone, to ESPN2's College Football Primetime, part of the SEC on ESPN. From downtown to campus, knotted at 31, start of the fourth quarter. Auburn trying to remain perfect and move to 6-0. Kentucky trying to snap its 2-game losing streak in conference. Newton completes it, and short of the end zone is Zachary. It'll be fourth and goal coming up. Looks like, look to the bench, Newton, look to the bench. Looked like you wanted to stay on the field, no doubt. And in comes Wes Byram, one of the more reliable field goal kickers in the country.
Has to be a huge temptation if you're Gene Chizik. Kind of like the Tim Tebow type short yardage to go for it right here, but go ahead and take the points.
Byram's already made one from 38 tonight. This one from half that distance, 19. And he drills it right through. Bit of a victory of sorts for Steve Brown's defense. Chris Berman is your host for ESPN's two-hour pregame show, Sunday NFL Countdown. Tom Jackson, Keyshawn Johnson, Mike Ditka, Chris Carter, insiders Chris Mortensen, and Schefter. All you need to know, Sunday NFL Countdown presented by IBM on ESPN Sunday at 11 a.m. Eastern Time. It's been a tough night, meanwhile, for Kentucky's Derek Locke. Had a stinger, we're told, on that right shoulder.
Well, we talk so much about the two-man show of Derek Locke, Randall Cobb. It's Randall Cobb now.
Hey, Mike Hartline has done his share of the heavy lifting tonight, too, albeit quiet. He's 19 of 22 passing for 191 yards.
And the young running backs, you know, Raymond Sanders, Donald Russell. Russell have made some plays for Kentucky as well. No rest for this guy. He's going back there to return those kickoffs now.
Remember, the way that they started the game was with that good kickoff return. Set up their opening score.
Yeah, you get the feeling Kentucky holding to Auburn to a field goal right there was a win for Kentucky's defense.
Auburn has won 15 of the last 16 meetings against Kentucky. Kentucky stopping that streak last year in Auburn. This is Sanders on the return. Wasn't a thing of beauty. Takes it out to the 30-yard line, where it'll be first down and 10 for Mike Hartline. We talked about Hartline's struggles last year, Bob. He really did make it through a bunch of adversity. He started the first game, played well against Miami, Ohio. Then the next three games, played mediocre, struggled, was benched. And then when he came back, and arguably his best game of the season against South Carolina, he got hurt again. And for all intents and purposes, was done for the season. He's been the number one guy all year. That pass dropped. One of the few miscues you'll see from Randall Cobb tonight.
Mike Hartline has had such young wide receivers at Kentucky that has really slowed his progress down. I mean, everybody, all the fans want to blame it on the quarterback. It comes with that position. But he has really been hurt by a weak surrounding cast, to be honest. A little more experience now at wide receiver with LaRod King and Chris Matthews. And, of course, Randall Cobb.
Out of the backfield complete. Oh, what a stake and move by Russell. Oh. Stopped on a dime and didn't leave any change for Antoine Carter to pick up 10 yards.
Well, when you drop the big defensive end out in pass coverage, I mean, Antoine Carter's a defensive end. That's a tough assignment in the open field for a guy 6'4", 260.
He broke some ankles there.
Boy, good effort right there.
Zach Sanders Clayton. Again off the right tackle. Check that Russell. Picks up three on that play. Bob, how much does it affect your team when you plan so much to use one guy like Kentucky did with Locke? All of a sudden, he's gone, and you have Sanders and Russell taking a spot.
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, Locke has been durable. He had a knee injury a few years ago, but they went with Raymond Sanders, actually, number four, because he was more the style of Locke at 5'8", 185. But Donald Russell right now is emerging.
Second and seven. Incomplete, intended for Matthews, and that's going to be a flag and pass interference against Bell. To Charvion Bell. See his reaction.
Well, big Chris Matthews, I don't know if we've called his name tonight. About 6'5", 220-pound receiver.
Number 22, defense.
And he leads them in touchdown catches.
Exactly.
Bell is distraught. First down and 10 as a result. Inside Auburn territory at the 44. Russell gets to the edge and turns it upfield, squaring those shoulders down to the 39. Picks up four. Bates makes the stop. Let's check in with Wendy.
Mark, thank you very much. We check in at the Swamp, Florida LSU. This game over on ESPN. It was 26-14. LSU scored. Then the ensuing kickoff, Andre DeBose takes it 88 yards. It's a 26-21 ball game in the fourth quarter.
All right, Wendy, interesting day in the SEC.
Florida, so much speed. And always an emphasis on special teams with Urban Meyer.
Of course, if you're just joining us, if you've been outside or somewhere else doing something else other than watching college football today, Alabama was upset today by South Carolina. Gamecocks winning in Columbia. So a huge opportunity here for the Tigers against Kentucky in the SEC West. Third and six for Hartline and the Wildcats.
You have to thank Randall Cobb, don't you?
Hartline completes it. Matthews makes the catch for the first down. A 12-yard gain.
What good job by Hartline of not just taking off and running with the football, but staying under control, throwing the football off the scramble. Big first down on third and six.
Players shaking up down on the field. That's Nico Thorpe, number 15. This game, much like last year's, which was a close one. Hey, Randy Moss back in Minnesota. Brett Favre, those two teaming up to take on New York on ESPN's Monday Night Football. Vikings, Jets at 8:30. It all starts at 7 with Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's.
Nico Thorpe blocked a field goal in that game last year. It actually returned at 69 yards. But Randall Cobb, I mean, just watch this little cut up right here. That's the opening kickoff of the football game. So he returns kicks. He's a quarterback.
Part-time.
Throwback, touchdown pass as quarterback. He's a receiver. And he blocks. And he holds on extra points.
By the way, yeah, he's rushed for a couple of touchdowns, caught a touchdown tonight, and passed for a touchdown.
Yeah.
On first and 10, down to the 26, it's Russell picking up a yard on the play, brought down by Josh Bynes. This Auburn defense under a little bit of heat right now. Second and 9 coming up, but the Tigers, of their 5 wins this year, 3 of them have been by 7 points or less.
This Auburn defense, a lot of seniors. This Auburn football team, a lot of seniors. I think they're the second most seniors in the country behind Boston College. A lot of experienced football players.
Wide open on second and 9. It's King. And LaRod King. 5-yard gain. Looks like he got enough for the first down, or at least near the first down marker. Check that, they mark it back to 21. Third and 4 coming up. Got a timeout call down on the field by the Auburn Tigers. Pivotal play coming up when we come back. Welcome back to ESPN2's College Football Primetime, part of the SEC on ESPN. And a big third and 4 coming up now for Kentucky. They trail by 3 points. Trying to snap their 2-game losing streak. They're 0-2 in conference games. This is a must win for the Wildcats. Cobb in motion to the top of your screen. Hartline, Cobb. Where's the spot? It appears to be short of the first down. Zach Etheridge was there right away. Now, what do? Do you kick the field goal for the tie, or do you go for it?
Well, first of all, Zach Etheridge in the open field, man-to-man, on Randall Cobb. I mean, that is an excellent tackle right now. Looks like he's going for it.
Kentucky is 6 of 9 on fourth downs this year.
They're in the wild Cobb package.
Cobb keeps it, has went high and got the first down and a key block from Chandler Burden and Monsell Adelin. And Joker Phillips amped.
Excellent block. I mean, Monsell Adams just gets in the way of Darren Bates. Yeah, that was a big one right there. Fourth and one, you rolled the dice a little bit, but you saw who carried the football. They just snapped it to Randall Cobb and said, go get it.
It's Cobb again. This time brought down for a loss all the way back at the 18-yard line. Nick Fairley making the stop and a loss of 3.
Say Nick Fairley is having a great year. He is a penetrator now. Guy, a junior college transfer, really coming into his own.
I remember, Bob, last year this time, they were talking about the adjustment he was having to make.
Yeah, played 1 year of high school football in it.
Handoff goes to Russell. And that middle part of the defense with Fairley and Clayton and Blank really stoning Kentucky these last two plays. Third and long coming up. All back at the 18. This is the 13th play of the Kentucky drive. 8 minutes to go. Down by 3. Line given time over the head of Cobb, incomplete, and it's fourth and long. He was working against DeMond Washington, and this time you have to kick the field goal.
This kid McIntosh last week hit a 42 and a 50 yarder against Ole Miss.
Last year this time he was barely on the roster. Former walk-on. This from 35 yards out. And he knocks it through to tie the game at 34. With about 7.5 minutes to go. We'll be back in Lexington right after this.
At Cheez-It, we expect a lot from our cheese.
What do you call a cheese that isn't yours?
I don't know.
Nacho cheese. See, because it's not your cheese, but I said nacho.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Cheez-It. Because at Cheez-It, real cheese matters. And the Principal Financial Group. It's time to rebuild your financial future.
Well, as far as Kentucky is concerned, it's been a long time between drinks of water against top 10 teams. Last time they won against top 10 team, they defeated LSU in 2007, who was ranked number one at the time, in Lexington. Tied at 34. 7.5 minutes to go. It's been a very highly entertaining game, especially from an offensive standpoint.
Oh, a reverse goes awry, and dangerously, the look on his face says it all. A high-risk play. Zachary trying to take the handoff from DeMond Washington.
Yeah, Matt Rourke down there in coverage. You know, just because you have the reverse called doesn't mean you have to hand the reverse off. DeMond Washington really should have just aborted that reverse right there. I mean, Matt Rourke was right in the middle of it.
So that's not a hard and fast call then for the bench.
Well, it is, but at some point you have to take it off if it all breaks down.
Newton keeps it himself between the tackles, gets about three. Back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you, and we head west. USC and Stanford, Matt Barkley connecting with Robert Woods, 61 yards, is going to tie it up 24-all. This game over on ABC.
All right, Wendy, back to a second and six. McCaleb in the backfield beside Newton. Throws it up top, has a man. And incomplete at the 45, intended for Cody Burns. Chris Berman is your host for ESPN's two-hour pregame show, Sunday NFL Countdown. Tom Jackson, Keyshawn Johnson, Mike Ditka, Chris Carter, Chris Mortensen, Adam Schefter. They all get it cranked up on ESPN Sunday at 11 a.m. Eastern Time with NFL Countdown presented by IBM.
This crowd has it cranked up right now. It's a long way from Blenheim, Texas, right here in Blenheim Junior College.
He throws a dart, and Adams squeezes it, takes it away from the defender, Mosley, to get the first down. That is clutch.
The confidence just to throw that dart out there. That's impressive.
Adams literally wrested it away from Mosley and kept his feet in bounds, too.
Confidence to make the throw, or the recklessness to make the throw, however you want to look at it. But
when it works, it's confidence, right? There's Newton. Across the 25, out to the 27-yard line. Auburn with one timeout remaining. Kentucky with two.
Yeah, there's our Gus Malzahn card index, numerical, color-coded.
Kentucky got someone trying to decode that on the other side.
Yeah, this guy has no chance to code that, I
promise. He's not a stats major, huh?
Here's Newton. Gets enough for the first down with about 5.5 minutes to go. Picks up five.
One thing with all those cards and all those codes, there's a good bet number two is going to carry that ball. I know that much about trying to decipher all that. Somewhere in there means number two is a key player in this next play.
Look at its numbers in the first half and second half, respectively. Get a game's worth of rushing yards in the first half alone. Caleb gives it to Zachary on the reverse. And the Wildcat defense snuffs it out in a late fumble. Big hit by Nellums. But the ball recovered out of bounds by the Wildcats. It's going to be Auburn football still. Back to the spot of the fumble.
Second and ten.
I think that was a good call. It didn't look to me on first glance that Randall Burden had possession of that football before it went out of bounds. But the great thing about college football, we're going to take a look at it.
Oh, it came loose before. Now, did he get it? Now, he didn't have control of it before he got it.
Looked to me like his right knee was on that chalk line. I mean, it's close, but I think the ruling on the field is going to stand.
There must be inconclusive evidence, video evidence, to overturn the call on the field.
Auburn not afraid to run reverses. There's a lot of moving parts in this offense now.
The interesting thing, Bob, we were talking about it during the break, is for all of its quick pace and
and flashiness. It really is more a meat and potatoes type of offense. They run the ball a lot more than they did even a year ago.
Exactly right. They're a run-based three-back kind of offense. It's almost like a wishbone triple option kind of offense. Now, that is very close. Again, I think they're going to have to stay with the ruling on the field. Right there, that ball is being juggled. Yeah. There was a slight juggle right there. See, watch his right hand. That ball's, he's not really in contact with his right hand. I don't think that's going to be overturned.
Must be indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field. There you have it. Second and 10 coming up.
You respect these officials, don't you?
Yeah.
They don't miss many now. I think review has helped the credibility of officials because fans see what a good job they actually do.
Yeah, it's absolved them more than it's shown that they've been wrong.
Exactly.
Second and 10. Newton fires complete. Adams out to the 42 and has another Auburn first down. And the clock now, time now becoming a factor. Auburn with one timeout, Kentucky with two, an 11-yard gain. Adams, the go-to guy for Auburn. Led the SEC in yards per reception last year. Dyer, the freshman, and another first down for the Tigers. Stopped by Bailey.
They always have that ability to break one just north and south on you. That time, no motion, no misdirection, just a north-south inside zone play.
11-yard gain. Newton keeps it himself this time. Put his hat down at the 39-yard line, delivering a blow to Burden.
That sideline jumped up and down when he put that helmet down now. Hey, who wishes he would slide? It's the guys in blue wishes he would slide.
You got
watch this. Oh, he's looking to deliver that blow now on Randall Burden.
Remember, he's 6'6", 250 pounds.
This is a great drive.
Caleb in at tailback. Caleb gets the call, running off the left tackle.
No, we haven't talked at all. Auburn, one of the best offensive lines in the country. You know, four starters back on the offensive line. Not easy to play in a no-huddle, hurry-up offense as an offensive lineman. And they pull a lot of linemen, gap block, power block. Really a good offensive lineman. This guy watching the clock tick down.
That's got to be one of the more helpless feelings in football. 11th play of the drive, meanwhile, for Auburn coming up.
Kentucky thinking about using some timeouts, I think.
Dyer, the freshman, holding onto that football, picks up four on the play. It'll be second down, about six to go. Wes Byram has made some clutch kicks if it comes down to a field goal in this game. 4 yards.
Talk about a true freshman on the field, a first-year junior college quarterback on the field. And to take this football, 11 plays, 63 yards right here at the end of the game. Shows you what a good coaching staff Auburn has.
Look at Byron putting his hat on. Clock winding down. Clock management, always an issue. Newton dancing between the tackles and brought down at about the 27-yard line. Clock management, an issue last week in that LSU-Tennessee game. Some may have thought it was clock mismanagement.
Well, another good point Gene Chizik made. He has one coach in the press box that's entirely responsible with him for clock management at the end of the game.
How unique is that? Does that happen?
I think that's becoming more and more popular. We have one guy that's his number one responsibility, and you and that coach are in total communication.
Third and three. Newton keeps it himself. And number two, the Deuce, gets the first down.
That was a great tackle by Winston Guy up in that hole.
What do you call that timeout, Bob?
You talking about for Kentucky?
Yeah. But they've got two to go. I mean, you don't want
to
go.
Yeah, you're going to have to call it after this play if Kentucky runs the football. Because you can see what Kentucky's doing. They're now milking the 40-second clock, taking it down. Time is there on their side right now. So it comes down to Joker Phillips calling a timeout after this play. He has no choice but to call timeout after this play.
Newton. He's going to keep it.
Boy, he helped
runs
him there.
Runs out of bounds at the 20-yard line by stopping the clock. And
there's where you'd like to see Cam Newton stay inbounds.
Newton with a career-high rushing yards today. Has 183, 114 to go. Second down and seven to go.
Just looking ahead, Wes Byram. He has, what, 50 field goals tied to career record for Auburn.
They're well within his range. Newton runs it into the middle of the field. And Joker Phillips watching helplessly from the sidelines. Two timeouts remaining. We'll be right back after this. Let's take a look at our protection spotlight brought to you by Castrol GTX. In a pivotal play, speaking of protection, nice breakup by Anthony Mosley. Pardon me. That was Damon Washington on the play. Here we go on third down and two.
I don't think number two is going to hand this football off. He's back there basically in a, he's the only back there.
And they run it over the right tackle. And it's a first down for the Tigers as we approach a minute to go. Both teams with one timeout remaining.
Now if you're Kentucky, they're going to go ahead and burn their last timeout. Now you get into that strategy maybe of letting them score to get the football back.
Something just sounds counterintuitive.
Oh, I know. I hate
it. You think about that.
I hate to even bring it up, but it has to be part of the mindset of Joker Phillips because it's the only way you're going to get the ball back.
Welcome back to ESPN2's College Football Primetime as part of the SEC on ESPN. And waning hope perhaps etched across the countenance of that Kentucky fan. Meanwhile, inside the huddle, Randall Cobb, the unquestioning leader of this team, telling his team, hey, we've got to have some heart.
Well, you have a field goal kicker that's about ready to break the school record in field goals. He's had four game winners. Do you let him score here?
Newton keeps it himself. Well, they brought him down whether they wanted to or not. At the 5-yard line, Kentucky with no timeouts remaining.
And here's where you talk about decision making, clock management. If you're Auburn, you're obviously going to let this clock run down. You don't hand the football off. If you run a play, Cam Newton runs it with no exchange, chance of an exchange problem. But you may just take a knee right here, let Byram win the game for you.
18th play of the drive. And they have set the table now for Wes Byram.
Again, back to that point. As much as I hate it, you have to let Auburn score to have a chance to even get the football back.
So two previous plays, you just back away from the runner and let him go into the, do you help him up and put him in the end zone?
I mean, I hate it. I hate it. But they're not going to get the football back. The odds of Byram, who has four game-winning field goals in his career, he's going to, this will be his 51st career field goal, right?
School record. 2 seconds to go. The decision coming from the toe of Wes Byram. Back in Lexington, tie game, 2 seconds to go. Wes Byram now for the win from 25 yards out. And the Cardiac Tigers continue to get it done. Tigers win. You see how close the margin of victory has been.
What a drive by Cam Newton and that Auburn offense. I mean, that started back at what, about the 5-yard line? They took it the length of the field.
And West Byram wins it on his school record 51st career field goal at Auburn. And strike up a pose, perhaps, a Heisman one for Cam Newton, who put this team on his broad shoulders and provided so many key plays for them. As Auburn improves to 6-0, Joker Phillips will only think about what might have been as they lose a close one by 3. Final score 37-34 for the Tigers. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For the entire crew, I'm Mark Jones. What a night of SEC football. Right now, we go back to the studio. So long, everybody.